Good morning, everyone. Today we'll be talking a bit about the background behind how we perform our finite element method calculations. So inside we use Boost Proto to develop a domain-specific language for finite element modeling. And at the lower level we use the Eigen library, which is a library to do matrix computations. So we'll show how to use those two together and some other aspects of our domain-specific language. So yeah, brief outline. The main points in the talk will be about combining Proto and Eigen, about how you can make your language, when you define it in Proto, how you can make it extensible so users can easily add their own functionality without having to change the basic library. And then finally, I'll show some use in the real world, because these two first examples will be pretty abstract and you might be wondering what it's all good for, but then we'll finish with an example where we write actually a small finite element method application. So first of all, I'll give you a bit of context, so why and how this work was done. So in general, it's in the framework of my PhD, where I develop a Navier-Stokes solver in combination with a solver for a dispersed phase. So basically we want to track small particles that move through the air, so and problems of pollution and that kind of thing. So yeah, there are the advisors for my PhD from La Rochelle University in France, from the Royal Military Academy in Belgium, where I'm from as well. And from the Von Karman Institute for Fluid Dynamics, which is quite close to Brussels as well. All the code is implemented in an open source platform, which we call CoolFluid, which has its roots at the VKI, but which is now a collaborative platform, and so it's free to download from GitHub. So a bit of first look at the finite element method to show you why, in fact, we're doing this. So the finite element method is a very formal way of expressing a numerical model. And because of that, basically, once you define your equation and your domain, all the rest of it is standard stuff for the finite element method. So what you want to do is have a high level of abstraction, so you can actually retain the fact that it only depends on your equation, and you want coders, especially scientists, you don't want them to worry too much about C++ coding. So having a specific language, preferably one that closely matches the mathematics of the problem, is a nice bonus. So here I'm not going to explain exactly what it is. Those who work with finite element methods undoubtedly recognize this as a Poisson problem, which is in this case expressed just to solve the heat conduction problem. So if you have a problem of heat conduction in a metal rod or something like that, this is the finite element formulation for the equation. And this here below is the C++ code using our domain-specific language. So in fact, if you have to type this here, it's easier than typing the LaTeX code to print the equation here on the slide. So we think that's a nice bonus if you quickly want to develop an application. So why did we come to combining the Eigen library, which is already an expression template library, and the Boost Proto library? It's because of the way the finite element method works. You have small matrices that you will need to do operations on, as we will see in the final example. And so we used Eigen because for small matrix operations, it's really one of the fastest libraries out there that we could find. So, and then, of course, we have our own domain-specific language, which is at a much higher level, as demonstrated on the code here at the bottom. So we need some way of nesting Eigen and Proto, because Eigen is for the low-level operations, which you don't want to do manually, and Proto does the whole equation implementation. So then more to the point, what we will do today. First we'll show how to use Eigen inside of the proto library, which as it turned out was not completely straightforward because of the way Eigen and a great deal of the, older expression templates libraries work. They use a lot of references internally, and you can end up with dangling references if you nest them. And the second point that we will show is the adding of user-defined terminals, so how we can extend language. And this is something generic, it's not specific to our code, so you could use that in any proto domain-specific language. And then finally, we will show a small finite element example with only a very limited amount of mathematics, so you can easily follow it. So what are the different proto tutorials that we have lined up? So first we'll do some expression basics, and then move on to introducing Eigen, and then finally do the what was on the last slide basically. So what's important to note is that the example code that I give here is a standalone, and apparently it compiles, so you can download it on my GitHub page, and it's a small CMake project only requiring Eigen and Boost, so it should be pretty easy to set up if you want to modify some of the examples or experiment with it. So who here has used Proto to build a domain-specific language so far? Okay, just testing if everything works. Who hasn't used Proto to build a domain-specific? Okay. Okay, so then in that case I will go over the slides that I had prepared introducing what Proto is. So basically, as you have probably gathered from the previous explanation, it's used to build domain-specific languages. And in fact, it uses the expression template technique, but it allows you to build expression templates with a lot less hassle than you would normally have if you do it all manually. So that's basically the steps that you follow. You build the expression tree, and you can assign meanings to the expressions, but this will all become much more clear as we explain the three basic components of Proto, which are the expressions themselves, grammars, which formally define your own language that you want to develop, and then transforms, which are used to assign actions to the grammar. So the transforms are what actually executes the language. So let's first start off introducing the proto expressions. So the simplest expression is the terminal, which is basically, for example, just a number. That's a terminal right there. So we can create just an integer and then turn it into a proto terminal using proto literal. You can also do it in place using the lit function. And then proto has a built-in function to display an expression. So if you do this on or terminal expression, which is a complete expression in itself, you get as output terminal with value 1. So that's just representing basically the, let's say, the leaf nodes of an expression. With the terminal value, we can also get the value using proto value. And of course, we can now use any C++ operator to combine this terminal with other expressions into more complicated expressions. So this is really, aside from the include boost proto, all you need to get this functionality. So then we can extend this a bit. So for example, do a product to which we add a number and then print a tree, which gives you this result. So you see what you get is basically, it follows the precedence orders of the operators, of course. So the outermost expression node is a plus of or product of in term with 2, and a terminal of 3. So note here in the expression, I took the in term, which is a prototype, and then I just used the basic numbers from C++. And of course, because of the operator overloading on the product here, Proto sees that it gets a number and it automatically converts it into a terminal. So if you want to be safe, you can put lit around everything. But in this case, it's not necessary. So it automatically makes an expression tree. The same thing, remember interm is just a number, but nothing in Proto stops you from using it as a function. So then you get this tree function, which actually has three child modes. So the first child is the name of the function itself, which was in a terminal with the value 3, as we initialized it on the first slide. And then you get the arguments as we put them there. Same thing with the shift operator, which of course, again, becomes a nested tree the more times you add the shift operator. So up until now, we've just built expressions that don't do anything, and we can also not check if these expressions are correct. So what we have to do first to check if our expression is correct, so in other words, if it's a valid expression in the language that we are developing, is write what is called in Proto a grammar. So the grammar that we write here is a grammar that allows you to add two integer terminals. And the way you define it is like this. So you just create a struct, and then you derive from certain prototypes. So the Proto plus tells you you want to add two things together, and then the two template arguments tell you what it is that you want to allow here. So in this case, we just allow two literal integer terminals to be added together, and that's the way you have to read that. So this is really Proto's own language. You don't have to try to interpret this as C++, because of course, if you look at it as C++, it's just an empty struct that inherits from some complex type, and that's not really very easy to comprehend. But if you think of it as a Proto, in fact, this is Proto's own specific language to define a grammar. And if you think of it in those terms, this is really a very simple way to express that we only want to match adding two integers. So then we can use Proto to check if this expression is valid. So for that, you can use the Proto matches function, which you can use an MPL assert for. So everything I'll be showing is good old C++98 code, so it doesn't use any of the nice new features of C++ 11, such as static assert, which would be a much nicer alternative in this case. So here, if we check this expression, we add an integer and an integer, that will work fine. Because we specifically stated integer in the grammar, int, this one, which is an unsigned, it will fail the check to see if the expression matches. So that way you can define very strict grammars if you want to. You'll see later that we'll be much less strict in the examples that we give further on. So now, moving on to the final component that is in Proto, which are the transforms. So far we had a way to build expressions and to check if the expressions are correct. But everything we did until now would not add two integers together. So we still need to assign the meaning and implement the fact that we want to add these integers together. So let's take a bottom-up approach to this. And let's first define a functor. So if you want to use a functor later on in a Proto grammar, you need to derive from Proto callable. So those who went to Eric's talk earlier this week, this is something that will no longer be necessary in the next version of Proto. Then it can just be any functor. Good old C++, so you need to do some kind of result type declaration. So either you follow the result of protocol or, well, this is actually part of that simplified version. And then you just implement what it is you want to do. So you want to add two integers, a simple function call operator that adds the two together. So then we can take our grammar, which we had previously, the add ints grammar, which was just the definition that we have here. And so you say to Proto, when you encounter an expression that matches this grammar, execute or evaluate plus functor. So, I mean, it looks a bit uneasy on the eye with a lot of template brackets in it, but other than that, it reads very, very nicely, like plain English, in fact, almost. So when you have this, do that, and this assigns the meaning now to our grammar and our expression tree. So what we can do then, this addInst transform can be used itself as a functor, which takes as an argument an expression. So we create the functor and we give the expression as an argument, and this will sum up 1 and 2 and we get the result back. Okay, so that was a very basic example, only adding two integers together. Luckily, Proto has a lot of stuff to make more complex things simpler, and in fact, the functor that we wrote, we didn't really have to write it because Proto provides something that allows you to fall back to the C++ default thing. So here we have a slightly more complicated grammar that will allow all of the mathematical operations on any type, in fact. So if we step through this, we have, I removed all the Proto namespace references to fit it on the slide here. So first we have the Proto OR, which actually means you will execute all of these, you will try all of these in sequence. So when it is confronted with an expression, the first thing it will do is check, okay, do I have a terminal? If I have a terminal, I just return the value of the terminal. So okay, then it moves on. When we have, again, it's a nested OR here, when we have any of the mathematical operations, so plus that we had before, then we do the default C++ thing. So we just evaluate the operator on the argument using the normal C++ operator. Note that instead of int, I changed here to calculator transform, which is the type that we are defining. So this is a very important aspect of the Proto grammars. Usually, if you want a language of any kind of complexity, you will have to define them in a recursive way. So what this means is, if you hit a plus node, it will descend into the two children of the plus node and then apply the calculator transform again. So on the simple expression of adding two integer terminals, if it goes through this, the first thing it actually sees is the plus node. Inside the plus node, it tells itself, okay, now I need on the left and the right execute calculator transform again. So it recurses, it goes back for the first child, sees the terminal, converts it to a value. Second child sees the terminal, converts it to a value. And then, okay, it's finished with the plus node, it goes on, and then it says here what it has to do with the plus node, the default C++ thing, so just add the two numbers together. And so this simple grammar is enough to build any expression with any arithmetic of any type that supports plus and minus. Why any type? That's something I still need to explain. That's here Proto double colon underscore. This is the wildcard. It means our terminal that we have here and encounter anywhere in the expression, it can have any type. So that means, of course, that this grammar, strictly speaking, for practical applications, it is not strict enough, because of course you cannot do these operations on any type. It has to be some kind of arithmetic type, but for the example here, it's not useful to add the complication to limit this further. And so then you can see here, mixing different types in one expression and executing the transform works just fine. Okay, so that's what we have so far. We have a basic transform that can execute any kind of arithmetic expression. So this brings me to the integrating of eigen matrices part. Because we can pass any type, we can, instead of integers and so on, we can also pass eigen matrices and see what happens. So let's try that. So first we'll make a small test using a row matrix of 2 and a column matrix, and then a matrix C, which is just filled with 1s. Very simple things. So in the eigen library, it is completely templated on the number type and the size of the matrix. So we define for each of these matrices the type which contains the correct size, and then fill them with the correct values. And then, of course, these or really eigentypes, the values with the underscore mat. So we need to convert them. If you want to test what happens inside Proto, we convert them to Proto terminals using the same code as we've seen before, and taking a reference to the type. So in fact, these terminals are read-write. If you assign to them, it gets stored in the original matrix, assuming you have a sign in your grammar, which in this case we don't. So okay, the first simple thing that we want to do is B times A. So the column matrix times the row matrix here, which will give a 4x4 matrix filled with fours. So when we try that, we create the functor and call it on the expression B times A. Nothing could be simpler. And we get, as we expect, the four, the matrix filled with fours. So that works just fine, as you would expect. Then only slightly more complicated. So we take the same product and then multiply it with C, which was the matrix filled with ones. So that should give you a matrix filled with eights only. And then this is, in fact, where the trouble starts already. Using such a simple basic expression, you either get a crash, or you get a bad result, or you sometimes get the correct result, depending sometimes on if you compile in release mode or debug mode. So this was a bit of a surprise for me in the beginning. So what we need to do now is check, what does eigen really do inside when it executes a product like this? So eigen is an expression template library, which means that if you just multiply two matrices like that, the result of the multiplies operator is not actually a matrix. It is an expression template object that refers to both of its operands. So you can see this. This is what I use here to get the type to print out, so that's nice. If you have if you pass your expression to this function, you can use boost result of to get the type that would result from the expression. And then on that type, I call a function called print error, which doesn't exist. So if you use this on an expression, you get a compiler error that contains the complete type of the result of your expression. So that's just a nice way to print in a compiler error what type you get. So if we just do the product of A times B, this is what the compiler spits out as a type. So you can see it's not just a simple matrix as the type that we defined first. And it actually contains references to the left matrix and to the right matrix. So okay, these are references, and here. But that's fine, because here we are just referring to the matrices that we have constructed in our program, and these references really still refer to an object. So that's okay. Now, the slightly more complicated expression, what we get then is this return type. So now we should try to spot the reference here that causes the trouble. It's the one in front of the comma, which they all are. So in fact, here we have again a product of two things. The last thing that we have is our matrix C, which is fine to be a reference. But before this matrix, we have a reference to this whole thing that was returned here. So we have here a reference to an expression template that was, in fact, a temporary object. And that is where all the trouble comes from, because in the way you usually use eigen, this is not a problem. You get the same thing if you multiply, if you replace everything with only 4x4 matrices, except here it's clear to see. The second product, you just get two references to matrices. And this means that here it created really a temporary matrix. So for performance reasons, eigen will do this in certain places. And in fact, any matrix template expression library will have to do it, because evaluating a product is something you, in many cases, want to do only once, because each element in the result matrix takes a lot of work to compute. So usually, when you use eigen, this is no problem. You just write a single C++ statement, and any temporaries that get generated along the way, roughly speaking, they just live until the end of the statement, and you never get any dangling references, even though you take references to temporary objects. So if you do this in proto, however, something different happens. You get for this matrix product the tree that we have here, where we have an outer multiplies and an inner multiplies. So this inner multiplies, when it gets evaluated, there is a return statement here inside proto, the default transform. It returns, and you lose the single C++ statement qualification, and so the references to the temporaries become dangling, which explains that we get really undefined behavior, and sometimes it may work, sometimes it won't, depending on the layout in memory and so on. So then, how can we... So is this clear for everyone up until now? So how can we avoid this from happening? So okay, the solution is really straightforward in theory. You just make sure that the temporaries don't disappear. So instead of having a temporary, you store the data somewhere. In effect, the nice thing about proto is that we can execute a few steps all in proto that make sure that we can allocate storage for these temporaries and no longer have the dangling reference problem. So, and we can do this in a very concise way, writing a few transforms that allow us to apply this technique to expressions of arbitrary complexity. So there's no special rule, like I want to multiply three matrices, so then I have to do this, I want to multiply four, I have to do something else. Nothing like that, it's just a generic transform that works on any matrix expression. So the first thing that we have to do, what we are building here is a transform called wrap expression, which will wrap up certain parts of our expression to allocate storage for the temporary objects that are created. So the first thing to do is identify which expressions are problems. In eigen, it turns out that the references to temporaries are only created when we have multiplications. So identification is quite easy, we just have a proto multiplies. For simplicity, I just use a wildcard here, so it can be anything, but it's really intended for eigentypes. The reason for that is that actually matching an eigen matrix in proto is not easy, because the template arguments to the matrix contain non-type template arguments. And the proto wildcard does not work on a non-type argument. So you can't put proto underscore where you would have the matrix dimension, for example. Okay, so then we have to transform these expressions. So again, we create some sort of callable functor. And this functor will wrap up the problematic expression. So we use here something from proto that allows us to create a new multiplies node, which is wrapped up by this functor. And again, we have the same recursive pattern. So on the left and the right argument of the product, we also apply again our basic wrap expression template. So this recurses through all possible multiplies expressions. We'll see later how it works when you don't have only multiplies expressions, but also additions and any other kind of expression. So this do wrap expression transform, how does it work? Basically, what we have in this case, instead of a callable, we derive from proto transform, which makes this what's called in the proto language a primitive transform. And then it's prescribed that you have to have this struct called impl. And it has three template arguments, one of which is the expression type. One is a state type, which you can use for all kinds of things, but which I won't discuss at all today. And then there's the data type, which we will see returning when we talk about the finite element example. So what it does, it has a function call operator, which must return a certain result type. The result that we return is a stored result expression, which is the transformation of the original expression with storage allocated to store our matrix. Remember that it's not really trivial to just allocate storage for the matrix, because the matrix type depends on the size of the matrices left and right. And for performance reasons, we absolutely want every matrix in our expression to retain this compile time information of size. So this stored result expression here takes the value type, which is this precise matrix type that we want to calculate, and allocates the correct storage for that. We see later how this type is calculated. And so then we just return this stored result expression, the constructor taking only the expression as argument. So that's the stored result expression transform. What it creates is the stored result expression. And we see here at the bottom that we have our value type, which is the template argument, which is really the allocated storage. I make this mutable because in Proto often you get this expression as a const reference. So the easiest way for me was to make it a mutable value, and that way you don't have to const cast all the time. So what's important here? Well, is the some Proto internals. When you want to create a new expression that derives from a previous expression, you don't just derive from the expression, but you derive from proto extents. The reason for that is that otherwise, if you combine it with other expressions, you lose the fact that it's a stored result expression. So this is explained in detail in the proto documentation. And then we just have the constructor that takes that passes on the expression argument to the base type. And the other thing that's on here is the eigenmake aligned operator new macro. Why is that? That's because we have here really an eigen matrix type with fixed size. And these matrices, these are allocated using a certain memory alignment for performance reasons. And if you embed one as a member in a struct, you have to take special care that the struct also is aligned, is allocated in an aligned manner. And that's why we have the macro there. That's a proto-internal thing. So now we still haven't calculated the type of this value t, so that was in the previous code examples skipped over. So how can we get this result of evaluating the product? So again, we go back to our original calculator transform that we had, which described how to evaluate the expression. And we just use the boost result of, which will give you back what is returned by the original grammar, and which is in fact the reference type. So then you have to remove the reference to get the actual value type of the expression. So at this point, note that there's some kind of dependency again on our original transform. We still don't explicitly state how to calculate the return type. We just depend on our original grammar to provide the correct return type. And then we still have to remove the const from that. And then we can finally use that. That's for the expression, in fact. If you want to use the stored result expression, it also has to have the expression type without the reference. So that's why this line is still there. And we can then finally define the type for a stored result expression that we previously used. So of course, when we do all this and we want to store the result of a product in the expression itself, this is of course going to have an implication on the evaluation of any product node itself. We cannot just use the default C++ thing anymore, because this just returns the result of operator star between both matrices. So this was our original transform. What we're going to have to do is take the multiplies that's here out of it and do something special in case that we have a multiplies. So that's again going to be a functor that we have to write. So the grammar, it's pretty simple. When we have a multiplies, we do our own eigen multiply thing, which takes as arguments to our functor. We have three things. We have the original expression itself. We have the calculator, the result of applying calculator transform recursively to the left-hand side and to the right-hand side. So you have to write a functor that takes three arguments. And why do we have the first argument for the expression itself? Remember that what we're doing is we store the result of our multiplication, we store it in the expression itself, so it needs the expression to get to the value. And the rest is then pretty simple. So here you see the nice old C++ feature of what you have to do to declare the result type of a functor. So this is the result of protocol. It's obsolete basically with C++ 11. So this describes what the result will be of calling the operator here. And so what do we do when we evaluate our product? We now know that our expression has a value member, and we just assign the result of multiplying left and right to this value. And then we return this value, and because now the value here is stored, we can safely return a reference to this value, and any subsequent use of the value will always work as long as the expression is in memory, which it always is as long as you're evaluating it. So that solves the dangling reference problem. There's one more thing on in red here that is not explained yet, which is a critical part, is where we determine the value type of the product. So this is another meta function, in fact, which will calculate the result of multiplying two matrices for us. So luckily, Eigen helps a bit with that. So this product value type meta function, first you have to do all the ugly stuff, removing references and so on, and then you can call Eigen product return type, which is supplied by Eigen and which will give you the ugly type that we had before, which gives you the entire expression template that results from executing the Eigen product. Of course, what you want to store is not the expression template, but you want to store the matrix that corresponds to the expression template. So this is what the type here will be, something like coef-based product that we had earlier. But what we want to store is matrix of the same size as this coef-based product or whatever. And so that's why there's still this last line where we can use Eigen matrix base on this type, and then the plain object that gives you the plain matrix that corresponds to the expression template. And this is a value that we can safely store. So one note is that this code is incomplete in the presence of scalars. So if either left or right is just a double, it won't work because Eigen product return type doesn't handle doubles. So it's a bit unfortunate. So in my real code, I have still a list of further specializations for this functor. Okay, so then we can complete our transform to wrap up the expression. So there were still two missing things here in red. So what we did so far handled any multiplies expression and transformed it. But of course, multiplies expressions can be nested in an arbitrarily complex other expression that may have function calls, may have sums, shift operators, anything you can imagine. So two things that we still need to handle. First is a proto-terminal of anything. In that case, if you have a terminal, we leave it alone. We don't do anything to it because there is no when clause around this. And finally, there, recursing through the entire tree can be done very easily in proto using the annery exp primitive. So this will in fact match anything that's not a terminal. So remember, this is done in order. Terminals, we don't do anything. Multipliers, we do something special. Anything else, we recurse through the tree using the annery expression, can have any number of child nodes. So we can use another handy proto thing, vararg, which will allow you to match any number of arguments to this expression. So that transform recurses through an entire tree, takes out the multiplies nodes and adds the value member to them. So with this combined into our original grammar, we have in fact what we want to obtain. So now we can test this. You can see the previous example, b times a times c, works fine. You can go a bit overboard with the expression complexity. And basically, with just this generic code, you can handle expressions of any complexity, and it works now. So maybe a quick recap of what happens. So what you see here we actually created two transforms and called them both in a nested way. So the original calculator transform, which handles the multiply specifically now, is called eval, and then wrap wraps up our expression. So the wrap expression will take all the multiplies in the tree and add the value member to them. It will in fact internally call the calculator transform to get the correct type to store. So extending this to wrap other types is easy. It just boils down to modifying the calculator transform. And then finally, calculator transform evaluates it, knowing that it can now rely on storage in the expression tree itself to save its temporaries. And that way, the problem is solved. Yes. Yeah. In fact, here the plus operations, they might themselves take references to something, but what you're getting back here, what you take a reference to, will either be, in this case, the matrix C, that's fine, it's stored anyway, or it will be the result of some other expression, and the other expressions, the only problematic ones, are multiplies expressions. And multiplies expressions, if you take a reference to them, that's no problem, because you're taking a reference to the value that we're storing in the expression. And so, except for multiplies expression, all the rest is passed by value inside eigen. So the product is the only thing where you encounter the problem so far. Yeah.
So I assume eigen, just used on its own, optimizes chains of matrix multiplication to minimize the intermediate result sizes. Does this transformation interfere with that at all by forcing the evaluation of particular sub-expressions when eigen wouldn't have done them in that order?
Yeah, so the question was if this interferes with the internal eigen optimizations that it might have for optimizing a long expression. And I think it probably does. So that's a potential problem with it. I haven't really done extensive testing because this last example is already a bit extreme and don't really encounter it that much. But I think for some cases it definitely will affect performance in a negative way. So, but it's...
It's a classic trade-off.
Yes. Yeah, so the remark was that it's a trade-off between simplicity and getting the maximum performance out of it. So indeed, and I think in practice it doesn't matter much. Remember that a matrix product, it will be evaluated and stored anyway because of the way matrices work, basically. Okay, any questions about this part? Then... we can move on to the second example of things that we use in our domain-specific language, which is adding user-defined terminals. So basically means that you can, as a user, extend the language and include extra functions. So why you would want to do that is just add new functionality. You also might have a more optimized implementation of a certain part of an expression, and then you can just write that directly in a functor and introduce it inside of your other expressions. Or you might simply want to reuse some complicated code and write a special user-defined operation for that. So currently what we will do is in fact show you how you can easily add more eigenfunctionality. The only one I work out is transpose, and then a second one where we just create a matrix filled with twos in a user-defined function. So okay, small reminder of the proto expressions. So you can create two structs, one template, one non-template. And you can create a terminal that takes the user op template and takes the my callable as a template argument and create a terminal with that. That's just a proto-terminal containing this type. And then, because it's a proto-terminal, all the C++ overloads are defined, so you can perfectly use that as a function. So you see already from the terminology that this terminal that we created, myop, will in fact be the user-defined terminal. So user can always create structs and terminals. There's no limitation on that. And matching a terminal like this in Proto is also extremely easy using the wildcard. So note that you can nest the wildcard in a template. So we can say whenever we hit a terminal that contains a user op of any type, then do something special. And so that's in fact the opening in the grammar to start using user-defined functions. So what's the outline? Our grammar will catch all user op terminals. We have a special primitive transform that will handle calling the myCallable struct on the argument. So in fact, what you will do here, the struct myCallable in practice, it will not be empty, but it will be a functor. So we use the functor itself as a template argument, and then you can that way extend the grammar. So yeah, the user creates the functor and the terminal and then can use it just as he wants to in the expressions. And we'll see now how it works in detail. So first, here we have again our original transform modified to handle the multiplication correctly. And we will add a new transform here to catch these user-defined terminals. So we've already shown the grammar that matches it, which is just a function of terminal, of user op, of anything. We consider vararg because we don't want to limit the number of arguments. So our functor that we create as a user can have any number of arguments. Or in the case of C++, 98, 10 at most, but okay. and then we call evaluate user op, which is again a primitive transform that will evaluate things. So now we will see how this evaluate user op works. So what it does, again, it's a sort of a recursion. What's the argument to our evaluate user op? It is the original expression that we had, the function call. And it is transformed in such a way that every argument of the function is evaluated using the calculator transform expression. So this is a nice way to avoid having to do that inside the evaluate user op. You could just say, evaluate user op just takes the expression and then has to take care itself to execute the grammar on every child. But if you pass it this way, Proto will execute the calculator transform itself on each argument and pass along the result of applying this transform. So that makes the evaluate user op functor easier to write. So again, evaluate user op is a Proto primitive transform. So you need some lines of template code to calculate the type of the functor that the user supplied. So inside user op, the template argument of that, the calculated, we'll show it later how it's done. Computer result type. So once we have, well, for that, in fact, we call a second meta function as well, because this is an unfortunate side effect of the old C++, where you don't have variadic template arguments, so you want to handle any number of template arguments. So we first have to calculate how many arguments there are to our function, which is done by the arity of function from Proto, which gives you the arity of the expression, which is actually the number of arguments plus one, because the function has also child zero, which is the name of the function itself. And then we can dispatch on this number of arguments, and we have a list of specializations for every possible number of arguments. And here again, to execute the call, we have to dispatch again on this number of arguments. So I'll show now in detail how these different parts work. So first getting the functor type. Okay, this is some use of Proto supplied functions. So we can get of our expression the first child, which was the terminal itself, the function name, which contains the user op. The value, of course, is a reference. Well, of course, it is a reference, unfortunately, so we have to unwrap it again. And then finally, okay. So the child itself is a... it may be a reference or not, but it's still just a terminal. So it's not actually the user op itself, but it's a proto-terminal of user op. So we have to get the value, or more precisely the result of the value. And this is the one that's returned by reference. So once you unwrap the reference from that, you have the actual template argument that was supplied to user op. So to go back a few slides, the result of this calculation is my callable in this case. So. And then we have to call result of on this callable because it's a functor and we don't know how many arguments it has. We have to define a compute result type for any possible number of arguments. So the first one takes one argument. So you see this second nice feature of the old C++. I hope that this is, I don't know, this is fixed in C++11 that you can fully specialize structs inside another struct. Because here the problem is with the int dummy. If you want to specialize on the number of arguments, so here is the basic declaration of the struct. We want to make specializations on number of arguments. If you don't have the dummy there, you'll make a complete specialization or whatever it's called inside the class scope, and then the compiler complains that you can't do that. So that's why we have a dummy repeated everywhere to get around this compile error. And so you can get the result of calling our callable type on one argument, calling our callable type on two arguments, and in the actual cool food code, this goes on up to 9 arguments. So it's a nice list. Could do this with macros, but I don't know how. So and then the same thing is, so this was the compile time calculation of the result type of our functor. What we also have to do is get the runtime result, and that's why we have a dispatch function that again dispatches on the number of arguments. So if you have one argument, we call our callable with only the first child. So here we can use directly the child of the expression because it already contains an evaluated value because of the transform that we saw previously. And the same thing for two arguments and so on. So that sums up the internal mechanic of making the user-defined terminal work. And now we can create our nice user-defined terminal that will calculate the transpose of a matrix. So the actual code for the functor is simply this. We have a template function for any type of matrix, and we return the transpose of the passed matrix. So simple enough. All the crap there is the result of protocol that you no longer need in C++11. And then this is the functor. We create a terminal, user op, with template argument do transpose, which is our actual implementation. And we call it transpose. This is the static allocation that's discussed in the proto user documentation to avoid, in fact, order of initialization problems. So that's why it's brace initialized. This would be a const exp in C++11, probably. So let's test what we have. So we consider matrix C with that form, and then evaluate, again, the same transform as we previously had, extended with the user-defined operation, our transpose function. And we're perfectly happy. We get the transpose of this matrix. Rows became columns. So. Now, we might wonder what happens if we nest the transform. So transpose of transpose. In theory, it should work because the way we defined it, when we get a user op, we evaluate it recursively using the same calculator transform that also contains this user op. So any argument of user op that's also a user op gets evaluated first. And it should recurse no matter how many levels of recursion that you have. But still, it fails. And so the reason for that is that we pass here a matrix reference. The first transpose returns actually by value an eigentranspose. So if the second transpose operates on that, it tries to pass this as a this result as a matrix type, and then you run into some problem where a const gets added and the types don't match up anymore in Eigen, and you get a compile error. So what we do to avoid this is make an overload for this function in our user-defined functor. We have in fact now two options. Either it's something that resembles a matrix, like the transpose itself, and then we take it by value. Or it's a real matrix, and then we take it by reference. And so with this modification to the user-defined function itself, so it was not a problem in the generic framework, but only a problem in our own user-defined functor, then we can happily apply the transpose as many times to the same thing as we want, and we can nest it as many times as we want. Okay, any questions so far about the user-defined operations? Okay, then now I'll probably go a bit quicker about this to have more time for the finite element example, because this is more boring template stuff. There's a problem if you want to return a matrix from a user-defined function. It's the same problem as we had before. If you have here a functor that makes a matrix filled with twos, we return here the matrix by value. Of course, what we return is a temporary. If we will use that in the multiplies expression afterwards, again, we have the same problem. So here is the testing example. If we use just twos, it works. And then at a certain point in complexity, a reference to the result of twos gets taken. And it fails again. So what we want to do is, I don't want to return a value here, but I want to return a reference. But there's no easy way of doing that, because the type of the matrix, again, is only known at the time when this function is called. Matrix T is a function template argument and not a class template argument. And we don't know matrix T before writing our expression, so we cannot just allocate the matrix storage in a static way beforehand. So what we do is we apply exactly the same technique as for the multiplies expression. We calculate the result type of the functor, and then we store the temporary result in the function call expression itself. And so then we have to write our functor in a different way, assuming that we have stored data, and then we can store our result here in the matrix stored, which is given by the transforms that we have to write for that, and then return the result by reference, and we avoid the dangling reference problem. So there is a bit of a hack here, in fact, because note that we didn't change the result of protocol. So to the type calculation system, it's as if this function only takes one argument, and to the runtime system, it really takes two arguments, which is taken care of by the transform. And so I think this is going to cause a bit of problems if I want to convert this to C++11, because then you would use decal type on the operator and automatically deduce the return type. But then, of course, the function call signature must match exactly what you want to do with it, and you don't know store T. So I think in that case, I don't know yet exactly how I will solve it. So this is summing up the required changes. So our wrapping grammar needs to be modified to also wrap user-defined operations, store the result, and add the stored argument to the user-defined function call, as we saw previously. And so the problem of result of I already discussed. The example for this I will not discuss in detail. The required changes of the transformation, there is an example on GitHub that does all these changes as required. So it's the user proto matrix example. Okay, so what have we done so far? So we have shown how you can use eigenmatrices inside of proto, but here there is a one-to-one mapping between an eigenmatrix and a proto expression, so there's really absolutely no point in writing a grammar as we have done before, except to show the problems that you might hit, because might as well just use eigen directly in the cases that we've seen so far. So what would be a real use case to nest the things? So you might have collections of matrices. You might have generated matrices that you want to operate on, a large group of them, and create a higher level language. Or, as is the case for us, a high level finite element method language, which extensively uses matrices, as we will show next in the finite element example. So a very quick primer on finite elements and how they work. So we will only discuss two very basic elements, a one-dimensional line element and a two-dimensional triangle element. So the basis of the finite elements are, of course, the elements themselves. And an element is a geometrical entity which has a certain mathematical framework attached to it, which we call shape functions. So here we have the line element, and the shape functions that are attached are used to interpolate the values between the first and the second point of the line. So here this shape function takes one parameter, xi, because we have 1D elements, so xi varies from -1 to +1 along the element. The shape function here is written as a matrix, so we have a shape function n1 associated with the first node, and a shape function n2 associated with the second node. So if we set xi equal to -1, we're at the first node, you get here 1 minus minus 1 divided by 2, you get 1 for the first value. Second value, 1 minus 1, you get 0. So if you multiply this matrix with values at the nodes, you get only the value at the first node. So these shape functions, basically they interpolate a field between values stored at the nodes. So in the finite element method, what you have is all your data is stored at the nodes, and if you want to do something in between the nodes, you call the shape functions to interpolate the data. That's the basic idea of the finite element method. We can already see matrices appearing here. Here we have, usually the shape functions are written as a row matrix, N1 and 2. If I multiply this with the column matrix, for example, T1, T2 for the temperatures, I multiply the two, they're summed together, and we get a scalar value for the temperature at whichever parameter xi that we chose inside the element. Same thing can be done for triangles. And in that case, we get three shape functions, one for every node. We get two parameters because it's a 2D element, xi and eta. So that's the basic element inside the finite element method. Now let's see how we can define such an element in C++. And here we immediately see the eigenmatrices appearing. So what you want for performance, because all of these are small matrices, you want small matrices with compile time information on the size so we can use the fastest algorithms from eigen to do computations with them. So what we define first properties of the element, it has two nodes, it's dimension one, and that immediately from those sizes follow the two types of matrices that we can assign with them. One by one matrix for the coordinate. We only had xi, one value, so it's a one by one matrix. This may seem a little strange to not just use a scalar, but it's just for overall consistency. And the second matrix that we have is the shape function matrix, which is a 1 by 2 matrix, a row matrix with both shape function values. So what do we provide as functionality? First, we provide a way to calculate the shape function. So here you recognize we create our 1 by 2 matrix. Result 0 is 1/2 1 minus xi. Result 1 is 1/2 times minus 1 plus xi. So that's the same functions as we had on the previous slide. So we define those right there in a fixed size matrix. And we return the result. Second function that we provide here that's required in the example is what is the value of xi at the center of my element. So centroid, we return a 1 by 1 matrix which contains 0, because here on the line element, xi goes from -1 to +1, and 0 is the center of the element. Triangle element, almost the same. Number of nodes change. The shape function definition changed according to the previous slide. And the mapped coordinate for the center of the triangle is now this time a vector with two elements containing 1/3. Okay, so that's what we did so far was the mathematical description. We described one line element and one triangle element. In a typical finite element problem, you will have more than one element. So what we will consider is these two simple unstructured meshes aligned with three segments and four nodes, and then two triangle elements.
pretty deep to really like, I don't have to. So your approach, you would run basically a runtime integration on the shape functions, which are all known at compile time.
Yes.
So you would basically evaluate the matrix matrix product of something like 20 by 20,
yeah,
even though you know all the values already at compile time, which is.
So the question is, in Philip Allen's, you calculate integrals of matrix expressions, but these expressions are known at compile time, and in theory, you can evaluate them analytically and just write out the expression. That's what you mean, right?
Yes.
So,
of course, assuming that you know the basis at compile time, which is pretty often the case.
So there are two aspects in which way we deal with that. First of all, writing this code actually becomes handwritten. You have to do it for every element type that you want to use. You have to evaluate the expressions mathematically, and then write. You could use some automatic system for that, maybe. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, represent the basis at compile time again.
Yeah, okay. And then integrate it also analytically at compile time. Yeah, okay, so the problem with that is it becomes complicated once you have a complex equation and a complex element. Sometimes it's hard, or sometimes it's even impossible to calculate in. On the other hand, if you really want the speed of having this kind of thing, what we support through the user-defined terminals is, in fact, you write a user-defined terminal for your specific element type that contains all the analytical codes, and then you don't have the numeric integration anymore. And so that's because the looping overhead is small, that eliminates most of the concern regarding this. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.